These parents will scream out in decided silence, who sit their grandparents down and say, we have slipped a disc, help us please. Who give us back our nerve, who hide scissors when we try to cut people out of our own pages. Who show us the darkest corner of every door, they won't read out who I will love forever. As a part of my own self, because she obviated my homework and I obviated her coursework, and our teacher pretended not to see the missing C in our out of control, out-of-delete lives. Her key was broken, I'm broken, and so is she. But I have strung a series of words together to name our pain, and now we are in control of what gets cut. The silence recipients hid the scissors when I once ruined a picture day, but she said she lost them after she saw so much pain. She didn't dare name the lonely fissure in my thigh, a disc scratched unreadable in a jammed hard drive. Right click, rub some bog on it, see if it plays. This is called Teething Pains. It's from my very first niece. You were born when the leaves fell, caught in hands that reached like children spinning, dizzied with excitement, gap-twist and grinning as they raced around the playground, hands dilating and contracting, reaching for colour and catching. You have coloured yourself into your world in which you only see in black and white for the first few weeks. But one day, I'll show you how to split white light into rainbows and paint by numbers. Though we might not bother with dot to dots, because there isn't much colour in the lines between two ordered plots, and I deny the people who grouped stars into constellations. So I'll tell you to ignore them, to name the space between the star signs and tuck blue into bed at night, because Mary's jam isn't just any jam. It's plum. I'll tell you, moonlight won't split the way sunlight does. It won't part with colour. I'm afraid moons just wax and wane and take tides from us so slowly we do not realise the way each gram, mnemonic device, and sliver of sand retreats into our purpley sandwiches. No bits, no seeds between our teeth. Your mother said they hope you aren't colourblind, but it runs in the family. I don't want you to see. We have numbered teeth to tap in checkups, to name the thing that's missing. This is called Muzzle. Apologies to anyone who has a dog. I don't believe dogs love their owners. They've just got Stockholm Syndrome. I hear my granny's voice in my head every day. Better the devil you know. So, I have been avoiding eye contact with mirrors in case I see the devil. I don't. Or her iris blackened by a surgery gone wrong. Eyeball wandering around the room like an uncollared dog, taken to the point outbacking. It's strange to think a person will never actually see themselves in person. But we wonder why dogs bark at the postman, run after cats, we're told to chase our dreams, so what's the harm in that? Always a lens, window, mirror, tinted, smashed. 7 years bad luck, but I wanted rosy glass, not this truth. A cat has 9 lives and the right to go where it wants, but a dog gets a leash and Stockholm Syndrome. I want to know who decided this. I want to know why nobody is angry while I am furious, foaming at the mouth from atop my milky windowsill. Because they are muscling dogs saying it stops them eating things that are bad for them. Let them eat the alphabet backwards and regurgitate it so you learn to read their sadness. So you realize they love their fleas because they are honest and indiscriminate. I want to know why you don't feel guilty that dogs want to run away from Stockholm, you, me. When the this poem ends, I will have 8 lives left, and I know it isn't right. I will try to leave the gate open tonight. Flight attendants, we are on board for your comfort, but primarily your safety. Birds caught on camera still believe they are free. Not bees trapped under the flightlessness of paperweights. I ask swans how they feel about this, being folded and alphabetized without consultation. A magpie tells me she cannot travel anywhere alone. They will say she wanted sorrow. You tell me sorrow is desire over a cup of tea weaker than your worn-out knees and book-like spine. I hooked my raised pinky finger around your T9 and tried to turn the page. Left a trail of broken back and lines in margins I never meant to make a wishbone out of you. But I mapped your body out with lines real tight, no slack, for the world to see. Please fold along the dotted lines. I made you origami. I'm sorry. On a morning, I pray for my Bermuda to stop. In school, they told me there were 3 types of triangle, scaling the hardest to figure out with its uneven sides and angles, but now I am here. In a sea of boxes and broken suitcases for the 20-somethingth time, and the only needles I know don't point north. I have been waiting for evergreen, for pine needles to visit a real wood floor at Christmas, but I think I will always be deciduous, so don't decorate. Don't hang fairy lights on branches whose leaves threaten to strip bark and abandon angels just as the walls are bruised by color, which I admired before the ultrasound technician said the crooked angel on top of my tree suggested a problem underneath. So I cracked ribs, retracted the presence to examine the heart walled in by my ribs' best efforts. Let's call a cage a crib and admire its good intentions before they fold my artificial limbs into your box. Remove the photos of my mother and peel once worn friends off bedroom walls. Polyfill the scars, painted with thumbtack, puncture marks, fill me with electricity, clear the way for new impulses to start. You can't measure the way a heart sinks when you see the gap left by a Christmas tree in January. How am I supposed to believe in the permanence of people when I have peeled my lollipop stick frame of my father off an interior wall more times than it took to stop waiting for a Christmas card? So I don't decorate, but I hang a wreath, note underneath, outside my door. Gone away for the holidays, visiting family in Bermuda. And this is called Yellow. She hugged whiskey into my raw mouth to rephrase the pain, but I won't do the same for her. She's numb enough and knows I never mean to hurt her with my words, but it seems to be the side effect of a labelless medication. She knows whether I should take paracetamol or Brufen, depending on whether I have a fever or swelling, but she doesn't know the antidote for her own disease, or the way her silhouette shadows me in pubs, off licenses, white coat rooms, and X-ray stopped mid-zoom to examine the uninvited image developing in the dark room of my body. I swear it's an eye, and it winks. No amount of blinking will get the tears out of my ducts, the mess out of my liver. At least dirt has the grace to leave. My mother did not start drinking until she was 19. She has never stopped since. Some mother suffered a solar eclipse by a breaker of sandcastle-shaped promises, a who likes yellow houses though she lives